Hi everyone, this is Vidya Shree here. Welcome you all to this Jewelry Sisters channel. This series of videos will be a complete guide to the Consumer Protection Act 1986, and I will also be dealing with the Amendment Act 2019. Let us begin. The first part of the series, which mainly focuses on the five important things of this Consumer Protection Act 1986. The first thing which I will be dealing with, the introduction part, which talks about the what is consumer protection, and the second one, importance and the need for the Consumer Protection Act, and the scope, the wide scope and the applicability of the Consumer Protection Act, and the 10 important definitions under the Act, and the rights which are available to the consumers under this Act. The Act is called as the Consumer Protection Act, enacted by the Parliament on 24th of December 1986, and this Act was amended during the year 2019. And the main aim of this Act is to provide the protection of the interest of the consumers in the better way, and also to make provisions for the establishment of the consumer councils in different levels, and also to appoint the authorities for the settlement of consumer disputes in the different organizations and the companies as well. The ultimate aim of this Act is to provide and to protect and to promote the consumer's interest through the speedy and inexpensive redressal of their grievances. Basic aim of the 2019 Act is to protect the interest of the consumers, and also this Act was inevitable to resolve a large number of the pending consumer complaints in the consumer courts across the country, and it was a way and means to solve the consumer grievances speedily. After understanding the concept of consumer protection, and now in this slide you all have to know why this Consumer Protection Act has become so necessary for the consumers, because this will lies upon the three categories under which the Act has become so necessary for the consumers. The first criteria is that the consumers must be aware about the rights and the reliefs which are available or provided by the Consumer Protection Act. And the second criteria is that unorganized consumers. See, when I'm talking about the consumers, every one of you would be a consumer, because if you consume something, or if you go out and get any products like toothpaste, brush, or chocolates, or if you get any industrial materials or anything, whatever product it may be, the moment you get the product, you become a consumer. So the consumers need to be organized in the form of the consumer organizations, which would take care of their rights as well. The next third important criteria is that exploitation. The consumers in India are exploited by unscrupulous, exploitative and the unfair trade practices. If any company or if the seller gives a defective goods and promised that the goods is of the quality, but the quality of the product is not up to the mark. Or if the product which we have got is of unsafe, or if it has been adulterated, especially food products, or if the product is of false and misleading advertisements like hair oil advertisements. The seller of the hair oil company would give advertisement that if we use such oil, our hair would become thick and shiny in 1 week time period, but that is not possible at all. So this is a misleading advertisements. Or apart from that, the hoarding and the black marketing, etc., and all of these ways in which the exploitation can be done to the consumer. So to protect the consumers against such kind of malpractices, the consumer protection is needed the most. The scope and the applicability under Section 1 of this Act is very wide. As I told you earlier, Consumer Protection Act is applicable to all types of the undertakings. Let it be a big or small, whether it is a private or the public sector, or it is a cooperative sector, whether a manufacturer or the trader, or it may be the good supplier or the service provider. If any injustice is done to the consumer by any of those sectors, then the particular sector will come under the CPA Act. So that the consumer can file a case against the particular sector under the Act. So you can, as a consumer, you can be self-protected against the public sector undertakings like banks, etc., by using this Act. And also, importantly, the Act has conferred the certain rights to the consumers with a view to empowering them and to protect their interest as well. And these rights will protect themselves from the malpractices or the exploitations done by the sectors or the seller or the company. So they can seek compensation under this Act for the malpractices or the exploitations done to them.
As I told you earlier, the scope of this Consumer Protection Act is of very wide enough. The first scope is to protect the rights of the consumers at large, and the consumers' disputes have to be redressed in respective forums as well. And the third scope is to the consumer protection is applied to all the goods and the services irrespective of anything. And fourth scope is to cover all the sectors irrespective of public, private, or any other organization or the company. Everything will come under the criteria of this consumer protection. And the decisions taken given by the consumer court or the forums will be of compensatory in nature. And the main ultimate aim of this Consumer Protection Act is to establish the protection councils.
This slide deals with the 10 important definitions under CPA Act 1986. First definition is nothing but the consumer under Section 2, Clause 1, Subclass D of CPA Act. A person is called a consumer who avails the services and buys any goods for self-use. Please note it here very clearly. It must be of self-use only, but not if the person buys any goods or avails any services for resale or for the commercial purposes. Then it is not considered as a consumer. So the next definition is that the goods definition is not been defined in Consumer Protection Act, but then it is defined under Section 2, Clause 7 of the Sale of Goods Act 1930 as every kind of movable property other than the actionable claims and money, and that includes the stocks and the shares or the growing crops, grass and things attached to the and forming a part of the land which are agreed to be served before sale or under the contract of sale as well. So the next definition is the services under Section 2, Clause 1 and Subclass O of Consumer Protection Act means any description is made available to the potential like the services like banking services, financial, insurance, transport, processing, supply, or the electrical or any other energy or board or lodging or any other kind of services will come under this category of services under this CPA Act. The definition for the complaint is also made available under Section 2, Clause 1, Subclass C of CPA Act, defines as the allegations in writing made by the complainant that any of the unfair trade practices or the defect or the deficiency is there in the product against the service provider or the goods supplier. Complainant means a consumer or any other voluntary consumer association registered under the Companies Act or any central government or the state governments which can come under the category of the complainant under Section 2 Clause 1, Subclass B of CPA. The consumer dispute is nothing but a dispute where the person against whom a complaint has been made or denies or disputes the allegations contained in the complainant is called consumer dispute under Section 2 Clause 1, Subclass E of CPA. District forum is nothing but the consumer dispute redressal forum established under Clause A of Section 9 of the CPA Act. Deficiency in services is also defined under the Section 2, Clause 1, Subclass G of CPA as any fault or imperfection or shortcoming or inadequacy in the quality, nature, or any other manner of the performances is said as deficiency in the services. The practices which for the purpose of promoting the sale or the use or the supply of any goods or for provision of any services adopts any unfair method or the unfair deceptive practices including any of the practices like falsely representing or any other things which may be come under this criteria of unfair trade practices by the seller or the company or any organizations as well. A trade which tends to bring about the manipulation of the price or the condition of delivery or to affect the flow of supplies in the market relating to the goods or the services is said to be the restricted trade practices under Section 2, Clause 1 of Triple N of CPA Act 1986. So this is how the definitions of this 10 important definition under CPA has been explained clearly. So this slide talks about the rights of the consumer under Consumer Protection Act. The first right would be right to safety. This act protects the consumer against the goods and the services which are hazardous to life and health. So consumer safety is mandatory to be ensured by each and every seller in the market, and the product which they sell should not be hazardous to the public. So for example, if the seller sells the product or the packaged meat, which may be hazardous to our health, which, because the meat has been kept for so long a period in the shop itself, that cannot be sold because it is hazardous to the health. And the second example which I can give to you people is that adulterated milk. The milk, adulterated milk, which contains more chemicals, which will give more thickness to the milk, obviously it is hazardous to us because it contains more fat than any other minerals in the milk, as it is available in the ordinary milk, which we can get it from the cow as well. So the milk, the adulterated milk, if we use that, it is more prone to the heart attacks or the several other ailments to the human body. The second thing which we can ensure about the product is that the ISI mark, the product should contains the ISI mark. The consumer are to be educated that they should use the products which are having as ISI mark. The ISI mark is nothing but the assurances of the product or the quality or the standard of the product given by the government, because the quality is being assured by the government. So the product which contains the ISI mark is safer to the public or the consumer to be used. The next right would be right to be informed. So each and every consumer uses the product should get the complete information about the product or the good he intends to buy, including the raw materials and the ingredients used, or a date of the manufacture and the expiry, or the price of the market, that is the MRP price, or the quality or the direction for the use, etc. So information should be provided on the label or the package of the products as well. So if we go to our kitchen, we can see, we can take any packets from the storage box, so that it will contain all those details which has been given in the label of the packet itself. For example, the product which contains egg or not, or how much of chemicals is being used, how much of the raw materials and what all the raw materials is being used to get this product done, or if the product has been given any preservatives or not, and everything. And nowadays we find the red and the green color in the product as well. That is nothing but red stands for the non-vegetarian, green stands for the vegetarian. So these are all the details have to be there in a product, which the information has to be given to the consumers through this label or the details given in the package itself. So the next right would be right to choose. The consumers have the freedom to choose from a variety of the products or the brands at the competitive prices available in the market. So the consumers are at the fullest freedom to select whatever the product or the brand which they want to select it. For example, if I intend to buy any dairy products which is available in the market, the brands are like Arvind's or the Hatson, like several other brands are also available with that. So if the brand, particular brand, meets my satisfaction or the expectation level, so that I would give preferences to that product to buy. So the right to choose is right to choose, or the right to select has been given as a right to the consumers under this Consumer Protection Act. So the next right would be right to be heard. In this right is very important right that the consumers have the right to file a complaint against a seller or any other related person or to be heard in the case of dissatisfaction with the goods or the services provided. So this is a right to file a complaint to be heard in the case of dissatisfaction with the goods or the services provided. So if you or me feel that we are cheated or the services done was not up to the mark, then you can go and file a case in the consumer court. So nowadays each and every good organization have their own grievances cell or the mechanisms which is available in their offices itself, so that the consumer uses the product of the company will go and complain about or file the grievances to redress the complaint and to get sorted out. And also nowadays we can find many consumer cells and the consumer numbers which is available in the website of the company, so that we can call them and talk to the executive, and we can launch complaint in the website itself, so that our grievances would be addressed and sorted out as well. The next right which I am going to deal in this slide is that the right to seek redressal. In this right, the consumer can get relief in case of the product or the services is of dissatisfied or falls short of his or her expectation. Then the right is available under this Consumer Protection Act to file a complaint to be heard in case of the dissatisfaction with the goods or the services. So sometimes if you feel that you are being cheated or the services then was not up to the mark, then you can go and file a case in the consumer court. For the reliefs which are available under this act is like the replacement of the product. Many a times the replacement of this product is not possible because replacement of the exact products which you have got it earlier cannot be replaced at all, and up to the expectation level is also not possible. So the money is given back to you, or the additional compensation can be given back to you. And sometimes the removal of the product or removal of the defect in the product can be done, and the compensation can be a very big reliefs under the Consumer Protection Act. The last and the final right is provided under this Consumer Protection Act is that the right to consumer education. This right is nothing but the right to acquire knowledge and to be a well-informed consumer throughout their life whenever they are using the products. And also they need to be aware about his or her rights and the reliefs which is available to him in the case of a product or the services falling short of his expectations level. And I hope you all understood the concepts very well which we have dealt in this video, like what is consumer protection, the definitions under consumer protection, and the rights of the consumer which are available under this act. And the part two of this video's series will be uploaded soon. So stay connected with us, guys. Please support us by subscribing our channel, like, comment, and share. And also, please don't forget to click on the bell icon so that you can get the updates as soon as possible. Thank you so much, guys.